It's 2025 and you just got a laser. It's assembled and your software is installed, but now you're wondering what's next? Sit tight, I'm gonna help you out. Hey guys, my name is Sam and welcome back to Samcraft. That's right, today's video is about lasers and is targeted towards you, a new laser owner, or perhaps someone who's been with lasers and is curious what Sam's gonna talk about. Regardless, these are my top 5 tips and tricks to get you started on the right foot with your laser engraving hobby or business. Step number 1 is to go ahead and get it into your workflow that anything you start begins with tests. What I mean by that are test grids. Software has come a long way. Companies are giving basic parameters. Some of them have built-in materials libraries, but they should not be considered as a replacement to your own testing to validate or explore other options. My advice to you is what I do personally myself, and that is to always buy extra of anything that you're wanting to engrave. What this allows me to do is to literally burn a couple for learning, testing, and dialing in what works best for me, my machine, and that material. One thing to also note is that depending upon the color of your material, so in this case, let's talk about powder coated tumblers because those are very popular. If the powder coat is black or white or purple, blue, or red, you're going to need different settings for each of those. So if you are going to do black, get you a couple extra for testing. Same thing for blue, red, just go ahead and bite the bullet and buy extras of each one so you will always have those on hand and you know for a fact your machine, your product are perfectly dialed in. Regardless of what software you use to run your laser, whether it be an Xtool product, so you're using Xtool Creative Space, or it operates and is fully compatible with Lightburn and you use it, my recommendation is to back up your settings. If you go through the trouble of creating material test files or test libraries, which I say trouble, but it's really not trouble. It's very, very handy. Make sure you back those up outside of the software. I have personally lost material settings that I had saved in Xtool Creative Space when a new update was applied and they were overwritten. I was not able to get those back and that work was permanently lost. That was a really tough lesson that I had to learn as far as 1, keep your settings physical somewhere else, or 2, don't ever get rid of those first materials that you play around with and dial in your settings with. Keep them around. Sure, they're ugly, eventually things add up, but a storage tote of this stuff would have been so valuable to me at this point in time instead of having to literally stop and go back and find my settings again through trial and error and test array grids and stuff like that. Sam's tip number 2 is to always source the best quality you can for your materials. Whether you are engraving and cutting wood, acrylic, you're engraving metal, I mean, maybe you're cutting metal too, depending on the power of your machine, always start with the best quality you can. If you are utilizing blanks, so in this case, I have a flashlight here. It is anodized aluminum, but completely blank, no maker's mark or brand names on it. If you're utilizing things like this, try and buy them from reputable suppliers and sources. The reason I say that is because while this one may be good, if the supplier is questionable and I start to sell these, when I go back to order more, what happens if this quality has degraded and I no longer have the standard that I was used to? That's going to matter a lot. The same thing could apply with your supplier. If, let's say, they did a nice powder coat job with this one, but the next time you order, maybe it's a different Amazon seller, perhaps, and it's not powder coat. That's gonna throw a wrench in your workflow, and it's not gonna be fun. So from that standpoint, I really try and find laser sources, laser engraving blank sources, and purchase from them. I'll put links below to the companies that I myself have spent my money for in purchasing laser materials. There'll be places such as Maker Stock for wood and acrylic sheet good, places such as JDS Industries for laser engravable blanks, and JP Plus for laser engraving blanks and other type of things. Those are more than that, but those are the 3 off the top of my head that I knew I could give to you in a clear, concise manner. But what about Amazon? I hear you. Amazon is absolutely a place that you can get blanks from. That's in fact where this flashlight blank came from. My advice to you would be to carefully look at and gauge the quality of your item, but also order them ahead of time, make sure they're good. And in something like this, where you have the item go ahead and order them, get them in, and see how many are good, ready to sell, and update your inventory that way. That kind of mindset is along the lines of don't count your eggs before they hatch. I don't want to take for granted that I know I can order 100 from this company and all 100 will be perfectly great, ready to use. One last thing to consider in the world of quality materials is the reason you want quality materials is because if you are starting with junk, no matter what you do, you're just going to end up creating customized junk. So you want the best quality to begin with so that when you value add to this object, which is exactly what laser engraving is doing, you are adding value, it becomes more valuable. Your price point can increase. Your target audience can be of a higher price point or caliber. Your profit can be more. All of that really starts with quality products to begin with. Sam's tip number 3 has to do with safety, or PPE, personal protective equipment. Depending upon the laser you own, you may not need anything else to shield your eyes and body from the laser beam, or you may be wide open asking for trouble. Most of the time, your gantry machines will have the option or will come with a full enclosure, so definitely get that. Don't ever run your diode machine out in the open without an enclosure, not only for eye protection, laser beams to your eyeballs, but also from a fume extraction, noxious, gross, smoky smell aspect, right? We don't really need to be breathing that stuff in all the time. When it comes to galvo lasers, so those are the lasers where the head is fixed and it uses mirrors to just magically move that beam around. Some manufacturers include enclosures, such as X-Tool with their F1 and F1 Ultra machines. However, some may not, such as ComMarker or Monport you see over my shoulder behind me. In that standpoint, you need to put PPE on your number one list. Even if you get an enclosed device, make sure you pick and purchase a good quality set of safety glasses. Make sure they are stamped, they are rated, and they are protective for the light wavelength your particular laser is putting out. In this case, I'm holding some free Mascot name brand glasses. These are ones that I buy myself. I've always purchased for use with my lasers, and I own probably about 6 different pairs of these. Not because you need 6 at once, but again, as you move across UV to fiber to diode and CO2, you're moving across that light wavelength and you need glasses to cover you and protect you. But I also keep extras in here because my family or my kids may also beep up around in the shop and I want their eyeballs staying operational and in place as long as possible. Outside of eye protection, the next thing is just as important is your lung protection. This means fume extraction. If you guys see this big silver pipe right over here, that is a portion of my fume extraction I have in my workshop. I have a 6-inch diameter duct. It is piped up and out and completely exits my workshop entirely. Anytime any of my lasers are on, that fume extraction system is running. In addition to air out, you need to consider air in. So having a source of fresh air coming into your room. In my case, I open a window, which is across from here, let in fresh air from there, exhaust it out. You would kind of want to keep the stuff in mind to get proper ventilation in your space. The last bit of physical PPE I'll talk about is this guy. Hopefully you all know what this is. It's a fire extinguisher. You want to make sure you've got 1, 2, 3, 4, however many of these you can have, want to have, or need to have in your shop. Lasers are pretty much controlled bursts of sunlight explosion. This means you're literally playing with fire. And when you are done playing with that fire, or if that playtime goes a little bit wild, you are going to want to have one of these on hand. You will hate yourself if you have a fire or an issue and have never purchased a fire extinguisher. These guys are cheap insurance, definitely have it. Along with smoke detectors, carbon monoxide detectors, all of these things. Maybe it's the fireman's son coming out in me, but you gotta have them. So if you buy a laser, get this stuff too, because the goal overall is not to die. Sam's tip number 4 is all about performance enhancement devices. Jigs, fixtures, fences, whatever you want to call it, the little things that you add to your laser to hold the things you're making in place, yeah, these guys are really, really handy. Whether you are doing laser engraving as a hobby or a business, if you ever find yourself engraving more than one of the same thing, a fixture or a jig is your best friend. They can give you increased efficiency if you're batching out jobs. They also give you the ability to have repeatable outcomes. So let's say one day I want to set these guys up. If I have a jig for them, engrave them, great. If I move that jig, I can bring it back and do it again. It's the repeatability that really gives you, I guess, a return on your investment over and over and over the more you use it. Another thing to consider about jigs is that if you ever have yourself in a position where you are not the only one running your lasers, say you have family that come and help you, friends that come over, or you hire an employee, having a jig or a fixture is going to be required at that point. The ability to have that person who may not be as well versed with lasers as you are, take your object, plop it, engrave it, remove it, add another one, and physically just do this over and over is worth so much more than that jig is going to cost you. And then the last point when it comes to jigs is that having a jig can reduce your waste. So if you have it's set up, you're good to go. You're not going to have positioning errors or things along those lines because it's physically in the same location time after time. Last but not least is Sam's tip number 5, and we're going to call this one online communities. No one knows everything about laser engraving. Not even the manufacturers who make the products, the people who design the software, or guys that get on camera on YouTube and present things as if they know everything. It's just not going to happen. So my advice to you is educate yourself as best you can from all these sources, but at the same time, cultivate or become part of an online community that can be your phone a friend, need help, place where you can go search for pinpoint advice or information, and basically be a lifeline for you when you find yourself in a predicament that you don't know the answer to right offhand. I have personally utilized this a lot of times, whether it be, hey, the software just got updated, what's going on? Hop on the forums. Usually there's already going to be conversations about that if it's a real-time event. Great, see what they say, rock and roll, good to go. Or maybe it's the fact that I've got a machine that is new to me, but not new to the market, and I want to see what other people have recommended for settings. Yes, okay, this negates point number one, test grids. But let's be honest, we all are guilty of doing this. I could go into a particular group, search for comm marker, Omni 1, UV, and then leather, and kind of see what people are getting, see if people are using it, see if they're telling me, hey, it's great, but this is terrible, that kind of stuff. Online communities are a wonderful resource nowadays for basically little ecosystems and worlds of particular knowledge about an item or subject, and are definitely invaluable and something that I use pretty much every single day to either learn, stay on the curve of, or just enjoy and try and help others as I can as I interact and participate in them as well. Well guys, there is Sam's top 5 tips and tricks for you as you just got your laser, or maybe you've had a laser and were curious to see what I said. Number 1, test grids. Number 2, quality. Number 3 is PPE. Number 4 being performance enhancing jigs. And then of course, number 5 being networking, online communities. I'm interested to know what you think about my top 5. Do you have others that you would say, you know what? I don't think your number 5 is correct. Here are my top 5. If so, definitely leave a comment down below, not only for me, but for anyone else who's here from the future as they go scrolling and looking at the comments to, in a sense, create a small little micro online community around this subject as well. Otherwise, thanks for watching as always. Take care, and I'll see you guys next time in the workshop.